dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, John put on Christ, so in Christ may John be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. We gather to praise God, not as those who have no hope, but those who know their hope is in Christ Jesus. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us peace and grace, that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow hope, in death resurrection.
First, giving honor to God, to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to the presence of the Holy Spirit, we welcome you to this memorial service for our brother and friend, John Taylor. Amen. I want this family to know and the world to know that for me, John was a, Brother Taylor was a confidant and a friend, as well as a brother. I truly miss him, but God is good. Hallelujah. Amen. And let me offer these words of comfort to the family and to his friends. The story is told of a young man who left home. And when he returned several years later, as he was driving back, he started to remember all of his childhood. And he had a special remembrance of a shop, a store that he went to every Saturday where the gang gathered together. And he made it his intention to visit that store as soon as he got back in the city where he had grown up. In fact, he went to the store before he even went to his house, to regain the memories that he had experienced during his childhood. When he drove up on the store, he found himself very disappointed because that place had been boarded up. Boards was on the window, the doors were closed and had boards on the doors, and he was taken aback. He was very, very disappointed. It kind of broke his heart because the place where he had so many wonderful memories in growing up in this particular town, the place had just gone to shambles. And so as he turned away to go to his car, he noticed there was a sign on the door. And so he went and he read the sign. And the sign said, "Still in business, just moved upstairs." Amen. And that's what I want to say about Brother Taylor. He's still in business. He's just moved upstairs. Praise the Lord. His influence is still influencing. His presence, though not physical, is still with us. Yes, indeed. Brother Taylor is still in business. He's just moved upstairs. Now we will have a congregational hymn. being mine. Every head bowed, every eye shut. Let every hand now be still. Every mind stayed on Jesus, and every heart now filled with the love of God as we go to God in prayer. Father God, we come at this time to say thank you, Father, for all the blessings you have bestowed upon us. Thank you for keeping us day by day. Thank you, Father, for keeping us through our trials, troubles, and tribulations. You have been too wonderful to us, and even though we did not deserve it, you blessed us anyhow. And right now, Father, we want to thank you especially for the life of Brother John Taylor and what he has meant to all of us. And Father, we pray that you would continue to encourage his family, his friends, and all of us. And let us cherish the memories that we have of Brother Taylor. We ask that you just continue to comfort his family and keep them. Father, we pray that you would let your spirit fall fresh on us all. Please now, in the name of Jesus, we pray, amen. We'll now have a musical selection by Mrs. Kelly Terrell. Our scripture lesson this morning will be given by Reverend Myron Conte.
Greetings, everyone. I will be reading the Old and New Testament. The Old Testament reading will be Psalms 23. And the word of the Lord said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of the death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The New Testament reading will be 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. May the Lord have a blessing upon the reading and hearing of his holy word.
Amen. We'll have another musical selection by Elder Mayfield Small, the Corinthian song.
To Sister B. Taylor and the entire Taylor family, I bring you greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I am so thankful for the opportunity to be able to do this for comfort for the family and in honor of my brother, John Taylor. May God bless you and may heaven smile upon you. The Corinthian song.
Inside of me, I've got this treasure inside.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
We'll have acknowledgments now from family and friends.
Hello, everyone. It's Bo White. I was told I had 2 minutes, but I don't know how anybody from Alexandria can talk about Jazzy JT in 2 minutes. It's impossible, but I'm gonna make this happen real quick. Let me tell y'all, I'm 42 years old. I've been known Granddad for 37 years, and he has taken me in from day one. Him and Grandma has treated me the exact same way they've treated their other grandkids. I've called him Granddad for 37 years. He's truly the only granddad that I've ever had that treated me just like family. I was family. I am family. The Taylor family is awesome. Granddad, we miss you. We love you. The memories will always be here. The fun times we had coming up. Me stealing your eternity cologne every morning before going to school that you had no idea about, but I did finally come clean and tell you I stole your cologne every morning. And me and Damien stole your car when y'all went on vacation one time. I came clean with that, but it was years later, so you couldn't do anything about it. You just smile. You still call me a fool, though. He'll definitely call you a fool or a dummy in a minute. But he definitely loved me as I was blood. So, Granddad, we love you. Till we meet again. Peace.
My name is Harold Hughes. I am the exalted ruler of Alexandria Lodge number 48, located in Alexandria, Virginia. I'm here to talk about Brother John L. Taylor. Brother Taylor served Alexandria Lodge for over 50 years. He served as the exalted ruler. But most of all, John Taylor served and loved chairing the Senior Citizens Committee. He served in that capacity for over 20 years. John was inspirational in getting the Janet Lee Center when the Senior Citizens pre-Thanksgiving dinner became too large to be held in the lodge. He managed to get it held into the recreation department at Janet Lee, where we served over 300 senior citizens of all races and religions without any cost. John Taylor served and was a confidant to myself and encouraged me to run for the position of Exalted Ruler, which I serve as right now. John Taylor was loved by all the brothers and the daughters, and he will be truly missed. So I say to you, through all the brothers of Alexandria Lodge number 48, Brother John L. Taylor, continue to rest in heavenly peace until we meet again. Bye.
A touch of the soul of a man. To the family and friends of John Leonard Taylor, greetings. I am honored to speak. John may have lost his battle with cancer, but he gained the victory with Christ. John was a man of strong stature, very much like his beloved dad, Mr. Charlie Taylor. John was forceful and determined in voice and opinion, very stern in his decisions. My journey with him was sometimes like a duel with swords, but always ended with an embrace, smile, and the words, "I know, I know." No matter what, when I visited John, whether it was the nursing home, which he hated, the hospital, or his home, he always had that same firm feeling with a teardrop. But he fought. He fought the fight that was always present, his resilience. Yet, no matter what we talked about, he always whispered to me his love and appreciation for his wife, Bee, and his two daughters, Karen and Rhonda. I had the wonderful opportunity to know John and to love him, especially during our visits. From us, he has gone, but we are blessed because God simply claimed his own. And when John arrived to his heavenly home, it was nothing for him to say but goodbye to us, because who knew his name, who knew his pain? Nobody but God, who welcomed John Leonard Taylor home. To the family, no worries, no concerns, no fears. He is safe in his arms.
Hi, my name is Lawrence Robinson, and I'm here today to talk a little bit about my friend, John L. Taylor. But I could talk forever about John, because if you knew John, you accumulated a lot of opinions and thoughts and so forth about John. But John, as far as I'm concerned, was my very good friend. Now, was John my good friend because we always got along? By no means. John was my friend because we could get along. We knew, you hear the term disagree without being disagreeable. Well, we were. If you look that up in the dictionary, you'd find a picture of me and John, because that's the way we were. He was a Cowboy fan. I'm a Redskin fan. Yeah, I said it, Redskin. And that never came up as a problem. It was a subject of conversation a lot, but never a problem. I remember we were on our way to go on a cruise, and we were walking down the street there in Norfolk. He had on his cowboy shirt and cowboy hat. I had Redskin shirt and Redskin cap. And a man stopped us and he says, "How in the world do y'all put up with each other?" We said, "We're friends." There's that word again, friends. You don't have to be in lockstep to be friends. You have to be genuine. The Elks. John and I could be in an Elk meeting and disagreeing on a subject. And when we left that meeting, we were in another setting and buying each other refreshments. That's what we were. Another thing that contributed to the relationship between me and John was the relationship between our wives. We were more like sisters than friends. And I guess there were times when John and I got along because they got along, and we made a foursome. John was a good man, and I'm going to miss John. I'm going to miss the relationship that we had. I'm going to miss the conversations that we had. I'm going to miss John as a man, because that's exactly what he was. Nothing phony about John. What you saw was what you got. John L. Taylor. You didn't leave a conversation with John wondering what he really thinks, because he's going to tell you. A genuine man, a genuine friend, and I'm going to miss him. I'm going to look forward to the day I see him again. Oh, yeah, we're going to the same place, because that's the kind of relationship we had. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Some of you may know me as Harold Roy, or as Junie, but I'm most proud of being known as John's brother-in-law. And I'm honored that John wanted me to speak at this service. As my brother-in-law, John was the person that I went to often for advice, guidance, or help. I remember in elementary school, I would ride my bike after school down to JCPenney's where John worked. Sometimes I went there for advice, sometimes I went there for guidance, but mostly I went there just to hang out with John. As I got older, I used to go to the NFL games that were watched on TV at B and John's house across the street from the police department. In attendance at these games were Donald Taylor, Alvin Taylor, Jack Carter, Leo Valentine, a loud group. Those games got so loud that on one occasion, the police came across the street thinking that there was a fight. John moved that NFL tradition down to Payne Street. That's where he didn't have to worry about the neighbors across the street complaining about the noise. When I was 16 years old, I wanted to get my driver's license. I went to John. We made a deal. I would teach him to swim and he would teach me to drive. John taught me how to drive, but I could not teach John how to swim. When I wanted to buy my first new car, I needed a cosigner. I went to John. John cosigned. John, all the times that you were there made me know how much you really cared. You taught me that the love that you give is the love that you get, and I'll never forget that. John was the only man that I could honestly say that I loved. And I had the chance to say that to John when I went to Alexander recently. May you rest in peace, John. Until we meet again, may God hold you in his hands. Your brother-in-law, Junie.
John Taylor, a man for all seasons and all people. He came to do the will of God, helping family, friends, neighbors, and all persons he came in contact with. If you needed it and he had it, you got it. He did the will of God his way. That was John. His passion was to take care of senior citizens. He was always looking out for the less fortunate by doing what he could. Not just a hand out, but a hand up. That was John. By example, he encouraged goodness and kindness in others, especially his children, grandchildren, nieces and nephews, and other young people, so they could instill goodness and kindness in those around them. That was John. He brightened the lives of so many people with his smile, his uplifting words, and his handshake. Whatever he could do to make your day brighter, he did it. He worked hard, ate well, and had big fun. More importantly, he loved his family, friends, loved his music, loved the Elks, and he loved his Dallas Cowboys. That was John. I remember the many vacations we took together, John, B, Robert, and me. John singing in the morning to wake everyone up. No, John really could not sing, but he knew we appreciated his made-up songs that did not always make sense. So he made them up and sang them anyway. That was John. John was a song you hear and you cannot get it out of your mind. He will always be in our hearts and our minds. He had that effect on us. The work John did speaks for him. The service he gave speaks for him. And the life he lived speaks for him.
Thank you, B, Karen, Rhonda, for sharing John with so many others. I'm sure when he got to heaven, he said, "Here I am, Lord. I come to do your will." Thanks.
Good day, everyone. First, giving all honor and praise to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to thank you all for tuning in today to this memorial service for my Uncle John Taylor. My name is Eric Napper. I'm his nephew. And I want to thank Roberts Memorial for this opportunity for us to memorialize him today. With all heartfelt thanks and all the condolences that came in, all the shows of love and kindness towards my family, my Aunt B, Rhonda, Karen, and the entire Taylor family, we wish to say thank you so very, very much. If I had to say anything about my uncle today, which I am going to take this opportunity to do so, just like he and my other two uncles, you know, my father played a little role in my family, in my life for me. But I never was without a father. With them, including my grandfather, Charles L. Taylor, I had four fathers, you know, so it was a good life for me. One in particular, I would say, when I was 11, 12 years old, my mom still worked at night. My grandparents were still working, and they needed someone to be a legal guardian for me so that I could attend Minnie Howard Middle School. And my uncle stepped up right away and said that I could move in with them. And I would also like to thank Aunt B for that too, because I know some families that the wife would not cooperate with that situation, and I'm truly blessed for that, you know. So I spent 2 years living with them, and I never felt anything less than being a son. And that's something that I will cherish for the rest of my life, you know. And then not too long ago, that same father I had to end up taking care of. And I was in a bind because I had to bury my father, and I did not have the means to do so. I knew no one else to turn to, so I went to my Uncle John. And I know the history between him and my father. They weren't the best of friends, but without a blink of an eye, because of his love for me, I had no problems doing what I needed to do. That just goes to show you the type of family that we have. You know, no matter what happens in our lives, no matter what the disagreements are, we have a way, which was instilled to us by his mother and father, Dorothy and Charles Taylor, that no matter what, family will always be family. And I want to just pass that on to you and yours, and hopefully you will have the same thing in your families also. So from my family, the Taylors, to you all, thank you so much, and have a blessed, blessed day. Thank you.
We ask that you would now peruse or read the obituary.
On April 1st, 2020, God dispatched his angels to bring home John Leonard Taylor to his eternal resting place. John was born in Alexandria, Virginia on June 21st, 1936. He was the fourth child and third son born to Charles Taylor and Dorothy Taylor. Growing up in Alexandria's Cross Canal neighborhood, John was educated in Alexandria City Schools, graduating in 1954 from Parker Gray High School. John enjoyed high school so much, his mother was sometimes in attendance at Parker Gray to quell that enjoyment a bit. His love of sports started when he was a young boy and intensified through his lifetime. If you knew John, you knew his love for the Dallas Cowboys. Parker Gray is where he met the love of his life, Beatrice Cross. They were married in 1955 and have been inseparable for the past 64 years. God blessed them with two daughters, Karen and Rhonda. John was a lifelong and supportive member of Third Baptist Church. His parents, his role models for life, reared him to be a responsible adult and to go to work every day. John's first full-time job was at J.C. Penney's department store on North Washington Street. Seeking some career advancement, he got a job at the Institute for Defense Analysis, IDA. This was a good job, but with a family, he felt he needed a job with more stability and provided more income. So he made a career change and went from the office to the streets. In 1963, John became a bus driver with DC Transit. John loved people and loved helping people, so this was a great job for him. When the DC subway system Metro was implemented, John was right there to move from the streets to the trains. Throughout his career, he received many accolades of praise and awards for his exemplary service. In 1996, he retired from Metro as a station manager. However, his love for service and people did not stop with Metro. For 12 years, he was employed by Goodwin House. The staff and residents of Goodwin House loved and respected him. They described him as caring, jovial, and easygoing gentleman, kind-hearted, a truly amazing individual. Following in the footsteps of his father and brothers, in 1955, John joined the Improved Benevolent Protective Order of Elks of the World at the Alexandria Lodge No. 48. As a member, he exemplified extraordinary devotion and accomplishments. He served as an inner guard, chairman of the trustee board, esteemed leading knight, and exalted ruler. He was a member of the past Exalted Rulers Council No. 25 and past State President's Council. His level of devotion to Alexandria Lodge No. 48 and Israel Temple No. 138 is unquestionable. Until death, he was a strong, avid supporter of the order. He chaired and served on many committees. However, his greatest passion was the annual citywide Senior Citizens Thanksgiving Dinner. He was the chairman of the committee for 25 years. It started with about 100 seniors, and this year they entertained and fed over 300. It was important to John that each senior felt important and loved, and he gave it his all to make that happen. John willingly gave of himself to his family and others without question or expectation of receiving anything in return. On February 28, 2015, Senior Services of Alexandria honored John and his family for their many contributions to the city of Alexandria. To know John was to love him. He is survived by his caring and devoted wife, Beatrice, two adoring daughters, Karen and Rhonda, three grandchildren, Damian, Grayling, Ashley Chandler, Lindsay Smith, 14 great-grandchildren, three loving siblings, Donald Taylor, Alvin Taylor, and Charlene Knapper, a son-in-law, Grayling Chandler, a granddaughter-in-law, Tiffany Taylor. John shared a special bond with his many nieces and nephews. He also leaves to cherish his memory, other relatives, and many friends. The body has gone, but the memory lives on. John Leonard Taylor will never be forgotten.
As we come to this moment in the worship experience, I want to say, several things. First of all, Brother John Taylor and his organization were the first outside organization to invite me to preach for them once I arrived in Alexandria in 2015. That's right, I'm the new kid on the block. I've probably known John less years or less time than any of you. Yet here I stand. And I want to thank Brother Jordan for his graciousness in sharing John with Roberts. Because when I first met John, he was simply B. Taylor's husband. But you know, time and circumstances can change situations. Between visiting B in the hospital and visiting John in the hospital, and sitting with John in hospital rooms and nursing homes and even in his home, he went from being B. Taylor's husband to my friend. And I'm pleased that my friend worked this out before he passed last April. Because we were in his bedroom, B was sitting on the bed beside him and we were talking, and he looked at me with that smile and he said, "Rev," I said, "Yeah, bro." He said, "I want you to do my eulogy." And I looked at him, I said, "Oh, John, you know I'd love to do that, but what about Reverend Jordan?" He said, I'll work that out. I want both of you to be there." I said, "All right." And you know, I've heard people say during this service today that when John wanted something, John would make it happen. So he made it happen. And it is my privilege to stand before you and conclude this worship service, this homegoing for John Leonard Taylor. I've always been drawn to elderly men because I think they have a wisdom that us youngsters can learn from. And I'm glad to have known him and to have shared with him. The only problem I had with him was them Cowboys, you know. I was a Steeler fan. But John loved his Cowboys. And so in spite of that, he drew me to him and shared aspects of his life with me. And we became friends. And I don't mind saying, I love John Taylor. He was all right with me. So my task today is a pleasant one and a hard one at the same time. But there are two words that I would like to share with you, two passages of scripture. One is in the book of Job, the 14th chapter. And therein you will find these words. It says, "Mortal, a mortal, born a woman, few of days and full of trouble, comes up like a flower and withers, and flees like a shadow and does not last." And then in the gospel, the 14th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, in Jesus' farewell discourse, he shares these words. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places." And today, I want to share with you for a few moments the troubles that we see. You know, Job has declared for us very eloquently, I might add, that all of us who are born of women have a set time to live. And in that time span, we can be guaranteed that trouble will dog our trail. Now, some folks' trouble might be different from your trouble, but all of us will have trouble. It is in the human makeup that as we interact with people, as we interact with this world, as we live in this world, trouble will find us. Sometimes we don't have to go out the door. Sometimes there's trouble in the home. Sometimes there's trouble on the job. Sometimes there's trouble in the church house. Just this past year, we've been having trouble in the streets. It seems like every time we turn around, some young black male or black female has run into trouble with our police force. Maybe that's a subject for a different day, but I'm trying to share with you that wherever we are, wherever we go, there is trouble knocking on our door. Sometimes we react to it. Sometimes we react violently. Sometimes we react vociferously. Sometimes we just chill out and say nothing because we have been told that trouble don't last always. And so with that mindset, looking at life as it is, knowing that we will encounter trouble, knowing that trouble will encounter us, knowing that life itself is filled with trouble, we look at those of us who are still here. Why? Because Brother John can't hear a word I'm saying. And he has lived his life. I'm sure, listening to him, he has had his share of troubles. He told me about some, but that's none of your business. I told him about some of mine, but that's none of your business. The point was, we shared some of our troubles. And you know, trouble doesn't have to be a bad thing. Sometimes trouble can be good. Sometimes trouble can make us get back to focusing on what it is that we need to be doing, because when we are left to ourselves, help me somebody, sometimes we get into stuff that we don't need to be in. And so trouble is out there, but we don't have to go meet trouble on trouble's doorstep. And so if we would just listen to that point of the scripture, if we would just listen to Job, he would tell us that regardless of what's going down, there's going to be trouble. And for some people, that might lead them into despair. That might make them a recluse and make them maybe want to lock themselves away from the world and not deal with things. But that's not the way. And that's what Jesus comes as a counter to. Jesus says to us, let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. And so, yes, it's a very short message today because you've been here for an hour already. You've listened to accolades of Brother John from his friends and family. You've heard wonderful songs. Brother Barrett just played the Lord's Prayer. And in that end of that prayer, he talks about the power and the glory forever and ever. Why am I emphasizing that? Because you see, Jesus said, don't let your heart be troubled. In other words, trouble can be all around, but you can sit in peace. You can rest in the assurance that Christ has you if you are one of his. Now, I'm not going to sit here and tell you that John was an angel who came down from heaven, because we don't have any of those walking the earth that I know of. But he was a man. And I believe from the bottom of my heart that he had a relationship with Jesus. And because of that relationship, the troubles that he encountered didn't have to last always. Oh, there's some things that linger on. There's some problems that we encounter, such as our health, that just won't let us go, won't let us rest, will not be in abeyance. But in spite of that, Jesus says, let not your heart be troubled. So those of you who are listening to this word today, whether you're on Zoom, YouTube, or Facebook, I want you to think about that. Think about the fact that there are situations in life that will dog you. There are situations in life that will bring you down. There are situations in life that will break your heart. But Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. What is your heart? The heart, in layman's terms, is that muscle in your body that pumps blood. But in the Bible, the heart is the center of your emotions, of your intellect. That's here. You can have the world going to pot around you, but your heart is at peace. Your heart is fixed. Your mind is regulated. You are focused on Jesus, and it does not matter so much what the world is doing, because you've got the peace of Christ. And Jesus said, I give you my peace, not as the world gives it. My peace will sustain you. My peace will hold you. My peace will rock you in the middle of a storm. My peace will dry your eyes when your heart is broken. My peace will give you a smile on your face when loved ones are being taken to the graveyard. My peace will hold you and never let you go. So Jesus said, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. John's got a mansion, y'all. You can have one too. I can have one too. What am I saying? What I'm saying is that Christ is preparing a place for his believers, that when he comes again and calls forth the dead from the graves, when the sea gives up its graves, that those of us who are left living shall be caught up to meet him in the air. And then we will see our mansions. Oh, I don't know what your mansion is going to look like, but I can imagine in my sanctified imagination that my mansion, it is going to be filled with music. It's going to be filled with scripture quotations. I'm going to be able to look out the windows and see the saints. I can see them walking and talking. Why? Because there won't be any crippled folk there. There won't be any sick folk there. There won't be any blind folk there. But everybody will be renewed. Why? Because the body that Christ rose and claimed for himself is one that he has for you and you and for me. Brothers and sisters, that's good news. So yes, yes, we cry when we lose a loved one because we won't see them on these dusty shores again. Yes, we hurt when we find out that a friend or a relative or any sort of loved one has gone on to glory. We are saddened because one, we miss them, and two, we know that that's our destiny as well. But there is a bright side somewhere. And I don't want you to rest until you found it. I want you to be about your Father's business. Yes, go through work and provide for your family like John did. Have an ambition so that you can make more, so you can provide for your extended family like John did. But don't forget, help me, Holy Ghost, don't forget to make that reservation for yourself. You know, it says that Jesus has a table. And at the table, there's an innumerable number of seats. And he says, choose your seat and sit down. And I don't know about you,
But I want to see Brother John sitting at the welcome table. I want to see my mother sitting at the welcome table. I want to see my sons sitting at the welcome table. I want to see Sam sitting at the welcome table. I want to see Piggy sitting at the welcome table. I want to see Pearl sitting at the welcome table. Why? Because their work down here is finished. And now, Paul says, for those who have loved Christ and who have worked in the vineyard, there's a crown laid up for them, not just for them, but also for us who love the appearance of the Lord, who wait on that day. Last April, John got that call that you cannot resist. Why? Because the angels came and collected him, took his spirit away. His body, we planted in the ground. And there it shall wait until Christ comes to raise the dead in Christ. But while you are yet living, while there's breath in your body, while there's nurture in your system, I suggest that when Jesus knocks on the door of your heart, you open that thing up and say, come on in, Lord Jesus. Come on in today. Come on in to stay. Servant of God, well done. You've worked here. Now your labor is finished. Jesus said, come on up just a little higher, and he will give you your just reward. May God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. Is my prayer. As we close with a benediction, there's a word I want you to hear. It's one of my favorite songs, but the word says, there's a garden where Jesus is waiting. There's a place that is wondrously fair, for it glows with the light of his presence. And what is it? 'Tis the beautiful garden of prayer. Brothers and sisters, I want you to see that image and to understand that metaphor, that it's not the type of garden that you plant outside, but it's that place where Jesus is waiting for you. Arms stretched out, love emanating from his very being, grace sustaining his arms, and power, oh, the Holy Ghost power, quickening him and quickening us as we come to that moment. Yes, we shall all pass this way, but not everyone, unfortunately. Not everyone will have that opportunity to meet Jesus in that garden of prayer. Children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, friends, make it your business to meet your father, your grandfather, your great-grandfather in that place where Jesus awaits. And then it does not matter what kind of trouble you've dealt with down here. Because troubles, heartaches, and pains will one day soon be over. And then we will walk up. We will walk the streets of glory and see our Savior. Amen, and amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Go with God. The peace of God rest upon you. The love of God support you. And the grace of God cleanse you is my prayer. Amen and amen.
Thank you.